Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Last week, we did a tafseer of Surah Al-Masad. A surah which marked the reaction of some of Quraysh, or an individual from Quraysh, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Lahab, to a da'wah jahriya, the open propagation of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, the week before that, we looked at the context in which Surah Al-Lahab or Surah Al-Masad was revealed in. And the context was that the Quraysh, automatically, they were going to reject certain things which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with. And the reason they had an issue with what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with, and an aversion to what he came with, first and foremost, was what? Because of Tawheed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's oneness in worship. This is the first issue they had. Although they acknowledge Allah Ta'ala is the only creator, is the one that gives life, the one that gives death, that, and at the end of the day, the one that deserves to be called upon, ultimately is who? Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. But their practices of it was not correct. The second issue they had was Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala's Tawheed in what? His names and his attributes. So they had ridiculous, erroneous beliefs concerning Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala in his names and his attributes. So they attributed to Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala daughters. They said the angels are the daughters of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and went through that. The other issue they had, one of the greatest issues, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always mentioned along with iman billah wal yawm al akhir, iman in Allah and belief in the last day. This was the greatest of their issue. A'idha mitna, that when we die, wa kunna turaba, and we become dust and we withered away, and we're going to be raised and resurrected again. So one of the greatest issues they had was what? Resurrection and everything associated with the hereafter. And that's why after Surah Al-Masad, the next surah to be revealed is what? Surah At-Takwir, which describes Yawm Al-Qiyamah. That the ulama say, whoever wants to see Yawm Al-Qiyamah as though he could witness it with his own eye, should read Surah At-Takwir. But what we're going to continue with today, inshallah ta'ala, from the seerah, after looking at the reaction of Abu Lahab to the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is to look at the reaction of the rest of Quraysh when this open propagation, when it began. Because not only Abu Lahab reacted after that, during the open propagation, everyone started to react. So what was the ways in which the Quraysh, they reacted to this open propagation? The Quraysh, they began with muharaba, with war. And the war the Quraysh, they began with, was a war that comprised of different strategies. But like all wars, past and present, they began with a cold war. Nobody launches an attack on a people or on a country except against what? Cold war. The purpose of the cold war is to weaken you internally from the inside. So when it's time for them to launch the open war, you're finished. Because internally the structure is destroyed. So cold war, the purpose of it is that they launch a cold war through al-ghazw al-fikri, through ideological warfare. So you find many places that were conquered, when the conquerors came, those people psychologically have already been what? Defeated. And with the Cold War is a war of infiltration. Infiltrate the general mass, that even the enemies, when they're invading, rather than fighting, they're welcoming them. And not only the general mass, the people of influence. Even if the people of influence, they're convinced that the war is wrong, influencing them through dunya, they'll accept it. So the Quraysh, the first thing they began with was a cold war. But they didn't begin with this cold war with anybody. They went to the most influential person that would aid them in this cold war. A person was close to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was like a father to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because the Prophet grew up as an orphan. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this person was like his father, it was his uncle. Not only was he the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he grew up, the Prophet ﷺ grew up in his household, and he loved the Prophet ﷺ dearly. But not only because he's his uncle, and he was like a father to him, because he used to refer to the Prophet ﷺ as Ibni, my son. This person, the uncle of the Prophet ﷺ, Abu Talib, كان الزعيما, was a tribal leader, a tribal chief. Not just any tribal chief, but Za'im Bani Hashim, the strongest of the Quraysh. He was the tribal leader of Bani Hashim, the tribe of the Prophet ﷺ. وَبَنِي عَبْدُ الْمُطَّلِبِ. So who is better for them to go to influence other than Abu Talib? So the first thing the Quraysh began with in their cold war was to go to Abu Talib, to convince him not to aid or defend the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, give him no protection. So the Quraysh, they went to Abu Talib, and they said to Abu Talib, that, Ya Abu Talib, oh Abu Talib, that this nephew of yours, Idna ibn Akhik Hada, this nephew of yours, قَدْ أَذَانَ فِي نَادِينَ وَمَسْجِدِنَا, he's caused us severe harms and is harming us in our gatherings and our places of worship. And they went on to say, فَنْهَهُ عَنَّا, hinder him from us. So Abu Talib called the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said to him, why they were all present, إِنَّ بَنِي عَمِّكَ, these children of your uncle or your uncles, your cousins, they've come to complain. يَزْعُمُونَ, they are claiming that you're harming them in their gatherings and you're harming them in their place of worship. Abstain from doing that. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at this point, he looked to the heavens, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he looked to the heavens, he said to them, the zu'ama of Quraysh, atarawna hadhihi ash-shams, can you see the sun? They said, na'am, bala, we could see the sun. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, fama ana biaqdar an ad'a thalika minkum ala an tash'alu minha bishu'la. He said, you see the sun? I could never leave this affair. In the same way, you could never leave off taking light from the sun or making fire from the sun. Because in those days, to light a fire, they used to use the sun, right? In the same way you could not do so, I could not do so. In another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if you support the sun in my right hand, the moon in my left hand. But this hadith is da'if. It has no isnad. Hadith is weak. Now, the hadith is weak. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said this to them, Abu Talib, he said to the rest of the Quraysh, he said to them, da irji'u, ma kadhaba ibn akhi, my nephew's never lied, so go back where you came from. This pained the Quraysh, that Abu Talib insisted on defending the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, protecting him and aiding him. It pained them. And this increased them in sorrow, grief, wa hasad, and jealousy. And one thing jealousy leads you to is what? To plot and to plan. So it also increased them in what? In makar. That now we've tried to convince him ideologically. He refused to accept this. So now, in the Cold War, what's the next thing you do? You buy people. And during this time, a lot of people, they sell out. So next thing they had to do in the Cold War was to try and attempt to bribe Abu Talib. So they went again to Abu Talib. They went to Abu Talib, Umarah ibn Walid ibn Mughira. With a young man called Umarah ibn Walid ibn Mughira. So they said to Abu Talib, Ya Abu Talib, Hada Umarah ibn Walid an had fata fi Quraysh. This young man you see is the most elevated and raised amongst the Quraysh. Wa ajmaluhu laka aqluhu wa nusrati, and is the most handsome and the best looking of them. We're giving you full usage of his mind, his aql, his intelligence, wa nusratu, and he will aid you in everything, and he will serve you in everything. And they said to Abu Talib, for what? Wa aslim ilayna ibn akhik, we want you to surrender Muhammad to us. Subhanallah. So we want to swap. You give us him, and we'll give you this young man, less than 40 years old, the age of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they said to Abu Talib, for what reason? To convince him even more, because it's something difficult. How would I give up my nephew to you? He said, give him up. You know why? هَذَا خَالَفْ دِينَكَ, this one is going against your deen, your nephew. وَفَرَّقَ جَمَاعَتَكَ, and is divided and caused rancor amongst your people. So now they gave him the justifications. Why should you give him up? And they went on to say, وَسَفَهَا, and is made fool or mockery of our people, all the scholars amongst us. So they said, these are the reasons. So give Muhammad to us, we'll give him to you. Why? فَنَقْتُلُهُ, so that we could kill Muhammad, subhanAllah. Imagine saying this is someone's uncle. But for them, it was a norm that if you kill somebody, you exchange it for someone else. So in exchange for killing him, we'll give you this young person. But they had to approach Abu Talib in this way. Why? Because they knew if they just went to kill the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam without approaching him, it would cause the tribal war. Because the Arabs, they fought over everything. If you go to the beginning of Seerah, before Islam, they will make a war for anything. There was a war once in Jahiliyyah, Yawm al-Basus, the day of Basus, between a Taghlab, is a war between Taghlab and another tribe. This day that's known as Yawm al-Basus, the cause of the war, we're going to go into this war. The cause of the war was the cause of a camel. They had a war over a camel. And this war was between Taghlab and Bakr. Just because one of the Sayyid of Taghlab, he had a special place where he kept his ibn, his camel. And another camel from another tribe or clan came into that area. So he threw a stone at it. Now a woman was there. She became Basus bint Munqidh. She was there, so she became scared. Just because she panicked, her uncle from another tribe, he came and he killed Kulayb, the Sayyid, the noble of Taghlab. They waged a war over this issue of the camel for how many years? 40 years. And they killed each other, slaughtered each other. Likewise with the case of Aus and Khazraj. So they knew, if we could launch a war for a camel, killing a noble from the nobles of Quraysh, this would cause a war. So Abu Talib, when they said this to him, and they made this proposal to Abu Talib, he said to them, "Bi'sa ma tusammunani." What do you think I am? How wretched and disgusting is that what you think of me? So Abu Talib said to them, "Wretched is what you think I am." And he said to them, "That you expect me to give you my nephew, for you to kill him, and for you to give me this young man for me to feed him and look after him? Bitsama to Samunani. How evil is that which you think of me?" Subhanallah. "Now I'm going to give you my nephew in order for you to kill him, and you give me this boy for me to look after. Hadha wallahi la yakun ma la yakun abadan. This is totally impossible." But Abu Talib didn't stop there. Knowing the plot and the planet of Quraysh, he called everybody from Bani Hashim and Bani Abdul Muttalib. The mushrik of them and the Muslims of them. That the Quraysh, they're plotting and they're planning. And everyone from Bani Hashim, the mushrik, from Bani Abdul Muttalib, the mushrik and the Muslim, they gave a pledge of allegiance. That if they harm Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's war, full out war. Except for one person, Abu Lahab. He said no. The only person from the tribe, also another person that refused, was Abu Jahl. Abu Jahl went to Abu Talib to ask Abu Talib to break the covenant, to break this allegiance or this protection of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when he went to Abu Talib, with him, with Abu Talib, was Hamza radiallahu anhu. And at that time, Hamza was a mushrik, was a non-Muslim, was a polytheist. So when he was asked to break this covenant, Hamza, and he insulted the Prophet ﷺ, Abu Jahl. Hamza, he took his bow and he broke it. He said, "Tash to Muhammad, you insult Muhammad. Ana ala deenihi. I'm also upon the deen of Muhammad. What are you going to do about it?" And Hamza was the bravest of the Quraysh. At that point, Abu Jahl, he left. So now they realize, if we kill him, we're going to have to fight the whole of Bani Hashim, Bani Abdul Muttalib. And Abu Talib is never going to be treacherous or betray the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, nor the rest of Bani Hashim. So now they launched an all-out war. That we try this cold war quietly, we're going to launch an all-out war. And the all-out war, which they launched after that, the Quraysh, was the all-out war that comes with a cold war or after the Cold War, which is Tashweeh Da'wati Rasul, to deface and destroy the reputation or to give a wrong impression about the call of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the Harb they launched after that was Harb I'lamiyya, a media war. So media war, which you see now, what they call propaganda war, it's nothing new. The Quraysh said, "No, we're going to do, we're going to launch a media war, an open propaganda war." To launch this propaganda war, they brought from the elders and the most wise amongst them from the Quraysh to chair this meeting. And this was Walid ibn Mughira. They brought Walid ibn Mughira to chair this war or this campaign, this media campaign. So when they brought Walid ibn Mughira, he said to them, "Qad hadara mawsim al-hajj." The time of Hajj has come. And what does it mean, the time of Hajj has come? Wufud al-Arab. All the Arabs will be coming to Mecca. All the different tribes will come to Mecca, and they will hear the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, in fact, Ya ma'ashar Quraysh, in fact, O Quraysh, Da qad sami'u bi amri sahibukum hadha. The Arabs have already heard of this. And when they come, the curiosity is going to cause them to go to do what? To listen to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he said, in order for us to launch this media war, لَابُدْ أَن نَكُونَ عَلَى رَأْيٍ وَاحِدٍ. We have to have one narrative, one opinion. And subhanAllah, you tell a lie once, twice, is regarded as a lie. But you keep telling a lie, people eventually will believe the lie. The lie will become the truth. He said, رَأْيٍ وَاحِدٍ. Consistency will narrate the same thing. All of us have to have one opinion and don't shift from that opinion. He said, فَاجْمِعُوا فِيهِ رَأْيًا وَاحِدًا وَلَا تَخْتَلِفُوا. And said, do not disagree on this opinion and do not contradict one another. طيب. He said to them, this is what we have to do. So they said, فَأَنْتَ يَا أَبَا عَبْدِ الشَّمْسِ. O father of Abu Abd al-Shams, فَقُلْ. Tell us and give us an opinion or narrative we could all follow. But he wanted to hear from them first. So he said to them, بَلْ أَنْتُمْ قُولُوا وَأَسْمَعُ. You tell me what we should say and I'll listen. So one of them said, تَقُولُ أَوْ نَقُولُ. Our narrative is going to be كَاهِن. That E. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a fortune teller. So, وَلِيدُ مُمْغِيرًا. He knows that they're not going to believe this. People will not believe this. He said, مَا هُوَ بِكَاهِن. Muhammad is not a fortune teller. لَقَدْ رَأَيْتُ الْكُهَانِ. He said, I've seen many fortune tellers. The speech which comes out of the mouth of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the rhythm in the Quran of what he's reciting is not like that of the fortune tellers. After that, they said, Naqul, we'll say, Majnoon, that is insane, he's a madman. Walid ibn Mughira, he said, Ma huwa bi Majnoon, he's not crazy. Ra'ayna Junoon, we've seen craziness and insanity. This person is not crazy. And his speech is not the speech of a madman. So they said, Naqul Sha'ir, we say he's a poet. Walid ibn Mughira, he said, Ma huwa bi Sha'ir. This man is not a poet. Qad arafna Shi'ir. No, 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 Shi'ir, poetry better than the Arabs. He said, we know what poetry is. And he said, in fact, I'm the best of the poets amongst the Quraysh. I know this is not poetry. After this, they said, Fanaqul Sahir, is a magician. Walid ibn Mughira, he said, Ma huwa bi Sahir. This person is not a magician. قَدْ رَأَيْنَا سَحَارَ وَالسَّحَرَ وَسِحْرَهُمْ. We've seen the magicians and their magic. فَمَا هُوَ. He's not like that. He's not one that's blowing and tying knots. So they said, after all these attempts, so what do you say then? What can we say he is? He said to them, قَدْ وَاللَّهِ. He swore by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ لِقَوْلِهِ لَحَلَاوَ. The words which comes out of his mouth is so beautiful and he has a sweetness. The Quran, subhanAllah. He says, who? Walid ibn Mughira. He said, إِنَّ لِقَوْلِهِ لَحَلَاوَ وَإِنَّ أَصْلَهُ لَعَذَقُ. And the root of his word is like a palm tree. Not only a palm tree, وَإِنَّ فَرْعَهُ لَجَنَاتٌ. And this palm tree is one that bears much fruits. وَمَا أَنْتُمْ بِقَائِلِينَ مِنْ هَذَا الشَّيْءِ إِلَّا عَرَفُوا أَنَّهُ بَاطِلٌ. All the things you come up with, there's nothing you're going to say from it except they will know it's what? It's falsehood, it's batil. Absolute falsehood. So he said, from all the lies we could come up with, إِنَّ أَقْرَبُ أَنْ تَقُولُ. The closest thing, he said, let me think, give me a few days to think about it. And after a few days he came back, he said to them, the closest thing you could come up with from all the lies, just say he's a sahir. Just say he's a magician. For him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he revealed the ayah. And how did he convince them he's a sahir? Because the words of the Prophet was not sihr. He was not blowing and not so tying robes. He said, you say he's a sahir. Why? He said, يُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَبَيْنَ أَبِيهِ. It divides between a man and his son. Between a man and his brother, and between a man and his wife, and between a man and his tribe. This is his sihr. This is the magic of Muhammad. That's why he's a sahir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent an ayah for him. ذَرْنِي وَمَنْ خَلَقْتُ وَحِيدًا. This was specifically for Walid ibn Mughira. Allah ta'ala told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ذَرْنِي وَمَنْ خَلَقْتُ وَحِيدًا. Leave me alone with one I created alone. وجعلت له مالا ممدودا, and I gave extensive wealth, وبنين شهودا, and children which are witnesses, ومهدت له تمهيدا, and I made all his affairs easy for him, ثم يطمع أن أزيد, and he still desired to increase him, كلا إنه كان لآياتنا عنيدا, despite everything I gave him, when it comes to the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, عنيدا, rebellious. إنه فكر وقدر. Allah Ta'ala said فكر. He thought and he deliberated. فقتل كيف قدر. May he be destroyed the way he deliberated. ثم قتل كيف قدر. May he be destroyed for his deliberation. ثم نظر. And then he sat and he paused. ثم عبس. And then he frowned and he scolded and he says, إن هذا إلا سحر يؤثر. This is nothing but magic. إن هذا إلا قول البشر. This is nothing but the statement of a man. سأصليه سقر. Allah Ta'ala said, I'll throw him into a saqar. And what is a saqar? لا تبقي ولا تذر. That a saqar is a fire that it doesn't leave anything to remain. It burns every single thing. لواحة للبشر. Subhanallah. Roast the skin completely. So Walid ibn Mughira, after this attempt, Surah 2 Al-Muddathir, 11-26. So after this attempt, this ideological or psychological warfare they launched on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is what they launch in modern warfare, psychological warfare, is that it still did not work with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even though they chose the right time, which was the time of Hajj, the right place, Makkah. It still didn't work. And even though they came up with examples of how the magic of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is, it still didn't work. So how did it not work? The reason it didn't work, that when the people came for Hajj and people arrived for Hajj, I'm going to go into this, that during this open propagation, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it didn't just begin with Quraysh. It started with the other tribes coming for Hajj. Because the Quraysh already, they were accepting Islam. They were accepting, but now they fear the other tribes will accept Islam. So when the people came for Hajj and they'll come to listen to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they accepted al-Islam. And one of them was Damad al-Azdi. And the story of Damad al-Azdi is amazing. Damad al-Azdi, he came for Hajj, he came to Mecca. And it wasn't just anybody from al-Azdi, his tribe, it was from the leaders of his tribe or his clan. So when he came to Mecca, the Quraysh, before he could go to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because one thing about media war is you want your propaganda to be out there first. They went to approach him first. And this one thing you should know, that the truth will always surface. وَلَوْ بَعْدَ حِينَ. It will always surface. So they went with their propaganda for war first, and they approached him. They said, look, there's a man amongst us. Even though they've agreed to agree upon one word. And what is that one word? Sahir. He's a magician. But subhanAllah, this is the reality of kufr and bid'ah. He always contradicts each other. So when they went to Damad al-Azd, they went to him. They said to him that we have a man amongst us. إِنَّهُ مُصَابُ بِالْجُنُونَ. He's a madman. Even though they agreed that what is a sahir, they said he is mad. Yeah? So he heard this, not from anyone in the Quraysh, Zu'ama al-Quraysh. But they were talking to the wrong person. Damad al-Azd. What was his profession? كان يعالج من الجنون. It was a person that treated people that were mad, mental illness. Subhanallah. Look at the qadr of Allah Azza wa Jal. He's a person that dealt with mental illness. So Samad, being that these are the tribe, the Quraysh, the Zu'ama, he believed them. He said, I believe them. So because I believe them, yeah, he said, فلما سمع سفهاء مكة يقولون إن محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. But when I also heard the sufaha, the ignorant and the foolish of Makkah saying Muhammad is Majnoon, he started to doubt it now. And this is the reality of media and propaganda war. Even the least person in the society believes that rubbish. The propaganda against Islam, he believes it. Rubbish, nonsense. Now I remember once watching a clip on YouTube about these people called the EDL, English Defense League, to show how ignorant these people are. They'll complain about masjids being built in England. And it's like, why did they have to come to our country and build masjid? Why don't they go to Mecca and build a masjid? Subhanallah. The haram is in Mecca, ya rajul. He's like, why didn't I go to Mecca and build a masjid? The haram, the biggest, is in Mecca. So when he started heading from the Sufaha that Muhammad is crazy, he said to the Quraysh, لو أني رأيت هذا الرجل فلعل الله يشفيه على يدي. Wouldn't you give me an opportunity to speak to this man? Maybe Allah Ta'ala will give him a shifa through my hands, will heal him. So the man al-Azdi, he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, Ya Muhammad, O Muhammad, إني لأرقي من هذه الريح. I could cure you from this illness of madness. وإن الله يشفي على يدي من يشاء. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is healed through my hands wherever He wills. فهل لك, what do you think? I heal you from this madness which has afflicted you. فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. The reply of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was not, I'm not crazy, I'm not mad. What makes you think I'm mad? After he said this, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم let him finish and listen to the reply of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. That was his reply, subhanAllah. The mad, when he heard it from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, أعدل علي وعد علي كلماتك هؤلاء. Please repeat it again. SubhanAllah. He was affected. He said, please repeat this again. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم repeated it three times. Dhamad, he said, لَقَّ سَمِعْتُ قَوْلُ الْكَهَنَةِ. I've heard the speeches of fortune tellers. وَقَوْلُ السَّحَرَى. And the speeches of the magician. وَقَوْلُ الشُّعَرَى. And the speeches of the poets. فَمَا سَمِعْتُ مِثْلُ كَلِمَاتِكَ هَؤُلَاءِ. I've never heard the likes of this speech. He took his hand and he put it in the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, أُبَايِعُكَ. I give you my pledge of allegiance upon Islam. And he said, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَى اللَّهُ وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, تُبَايِعُنِي. You give me this pledge of allegiance for you? He said, not just for me and everyone under me, for my subjects, his whole tribe. SubhanAllah. So this propaganda war, it didn't work. After Dhamad, other people, they accepted the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm going to go into that next week, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Actually, not next week. We're going to go into this when we look at Surah Al-Kafirun. Because after Surah Al-Kafirun, we're going to look at the fact this failed, the torture of the Quraysh. So now media war failed, cold war failed, so now it's physical war. Why they started to torture the Sahaba, kill the Sahaba, slaughter Sahaba. But this is after Al-Kafirun. But inshallah ta'ala, next week we'll mention some of them, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. But wanted to go into Surah At-Takwir, one of the cause of rejection of the mushrikeen. But one lesson I want us to learn from this, ad-dars and ibar, from this incident with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because we want to draw lessons from the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is the lesson that a da'i, a person who's a caller to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, she used that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put at his disposal. One of the things that Allah ta'ala put at the disposal of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was this tribal allegiance. And he used it to the advantage of what? The deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And all of us who come from different land, different countries, and wherever we come from, there's certain privileges we have that we could use to do what? Aid the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in some parts of the West, for example, they believe in freedom of speech, freedom of religion. We should use this freedom of speech to aid what? The deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of us from Africa, we have tribal cultural things, which are tribal things or habits that we could use to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, I could go to certain regions or areas of Nigeria, knowing that I have a family, I have a tribe, I could not be attacked. I could use that to the advantage of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is to be used, but not to be abused. So we find the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used this to his advantage, wherever you are. Because many people say we're on the sunnah. There's the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the sunnah of what? The sunnah of the universal laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this universal law, it takes hikmah. Look at the wisdom of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how he used this. And in some places, it might not be a tribal issue or culture, it could be something which is law, that you use it to your advantage. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he never abused it. In some places now, people abuse it in the West, that freedom of speech, and it gives a bad face to Islam. The Prophet ﷺ, he recognized the goodness of the Quraysh to him, and he was never ill-mannered towards them. So some of us, we come from the West, and there's certain things we could use to the advantage of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should not be of those people that are Westerners or can't Western people, kuffar passport, kuffar country, kuffar language, subhanAllah. That kuffar language gave you a passport and an education. I'm not saying your wala should be to them, but use that to the benefit of what? The deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's that the sha'ir, such an attitude, is that the attitude of the sha'ir, the poet mentioned. And this poetry is mentioned in regards to somebody you do good for and it returns a favor or a bad deed. The sha'ir said, that أُعَلِّمُهُ الرِّمَايَ كُلَّ يَوْمٍ فَلَمَّ اشْتَدَّ سَاعِدُهُ رَمَانِ. He said, you see this young boy? I used to teach him how to shoot a bow and an arrow every single day. When his muscle became strong, the first person he shot was me. The first person he shot is me. For some of us born and bred there and not born and bred there, they gave us certain rights and citizenship and protection, yeah, that we enjoy, to be honest with you. And the sha'ir went on to say, وَعَلَّمْتُهُ نَضْمَ الْقَوَافِ. I taught him how to make poetry and rhythms. فَلَمَّ قَالَ قَافِيَةً. And when he was able to make poetry, the first person he did the diss poet for was me. So whatever we have to advantage, let's use it, wherever we are, wherever we're from, for the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Next week, inshaAllah ta'ala, we'll be doing Surah Al-Takwir, not the tafseer, but rather the circumstances surrounding it. And you're going to hear some strange things that the mushrikeen would do to the Prophet ﷺ to reject the issue of Yawm Al-Qiyamah, taking dust, bone, blowing in the face of the Prophet ﷺ. We're going to be raised from this. And the week after that, or maybe next week, we'll try and do the tafseer with it, because we only got about 3 weeks left now. Then we'll continue after that now with the open propagation. What happened? What did the Sahaba go through? Because it's only going knowing what the Sahaba went through and what they suffered for this deen of Allah Ta'ala to reach us, we appreciate them even more. Any questions, inshallah? No.